Hello everyone, welcome back to my channel. This is Chemistry with Kat, and today we will be learning how to draw Bohr-Rutherford diagrams. These diagrams are named after the guys who created them, Ernest Rutherford and Niels Bohr. In this video, we're going to learn who these guys were and what their contributions were to science and chemistry. After that, we're going to learn how to draw these diagrams. Let's do it. This all started with Ernest Rutherford. Ernest Rutherford discovered that atoms have a nucleus. He discovered that the entire mass of an atom is found in the nucleus, as well as all the positive charge. We now know that the nucleus is made up of the protons and neutrons of an atom. This discovery won him the Nobel Prize in Chemistry in 1908. He also studied radioactive uranium and found that they give off both alpha and beta waves. Rutherford is one of my most favorite scientists because most of his research took place at McGill University, which is located in Montreal, Canada, which is my home country. So Rutherford was doing his thing, and then Niels Bohr came around. Niels Bohr was a physicist who studied electrons. He studied quanta and electron theory. Along with Rutherford, he was able to discover that electrons are orbiting around an atom's nucleus. He also discovered that the amount of electrons found in the outermost shell of an atom, which we now call the valence shell, determine the properties and characteristics of that element. Niels Bohr is credited for coming up with the atomic model, and that won him the Nobel Prize in 1922. Both Rutherford and Bohr have elements named after them, borium and rutherfordium. I'm going to go over the basics of the Bohr-Rutherford diagram and the rules to drawing them before I go into some examples. So the first thing is the nucleus. We draw a circle like this. Inside this nucleus are the protons and neutrons. That's what makes up the mass of an atom. Now we can draw the orbits. The first shell only holds two electrons, and their locations are at the top and the bottom. The next shell can hold eight electrons, and when we're drawing them, we draw them singularly first and then pair them up, like this. One, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight. The octet rule tells us that an atom always wants to have a full outer shell. So if it's hydrogen or helium that only have one shell, they want two electrons. But the next few rows of elements want a full octet, eight electrons in their shell. An element will bind with other elements to try and complete that shell, and that's how reactions take place. Let's start with the most simple atom, hydrogen. We'll draw the nucleus. Hydrogen has one proton and zero neutrons. We'll draw the shell. When the atom is in the neutral state, we know that the number of protons is equal to the number of electrons. The protons are positive, the electrons are negative, and if they're the same number, they cancel each other out and the atom is neutral. So in this case, neutral hydrogen has one electron to balance out the proton. So we put that up here. Hydrogen is so reactive because it only needs one more electron to complete this shell. It has one electron to give away, and it can bind with almost anything. Let's try another atom. This time we'll try fluorine. Draw the nucleus. Fluorine has 9 protons and 10 neutrons. We then draw the orbit. 1, 2, next orbit, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. Now you'll see all of the electrons are paired up except this one. So fluorine is going to try to bind with something to complete its outer shell. Now, a lovely question that teachers like to ask, especially in high school and even in first year university multiple choice, they ask, what is the most reactive element on the periodic table? Hint, hint, it's fluorine. Fluorine is so close to being a full shell, it can bind with almost anything to complete its shell. For my last example, I want to show you an atom that has a lot of electrons and subsequently four different electron orbitals. Let's do calcium. Calcium has 20 protons and 20 neutrons. If we're going to keep this element neutral, we need to draw 20 electrons. Let's do it. The first orbital is 2. Next orbital can hold up to 8. So number 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. So that's a little confusing because there's 8 electrons here, but 10 total. So I'm counting for the total. We need to get up to 20, and we're only at 10 so far. 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, still not at 20. One more shell. 19, 20. Now in this case, calcium can either gain 6 electrons to have a full octet, or it can give up 2 and then have the full octet underneath. It's most likely that calcium is going to give up or share those 2 outer electrons. For homework today, I recommend that you draw Bohr-Rutherford diagrams for the first 20 elements. I already did number 1, 9, and 20, but you can do those again and do the rest. I would also recommend that for elements that are in the same group, which is the same vertical column of the periodic table, I recommend that you do all of those together and see how their properties might be the same. You'll start to notice that the way the electrons sit and the way they might want to give up electrons or complete their shell is the same depending on what group they're in. Good luck with that, and I can't wait to see you tomorrow. If you liked this video, please give it a thumbs up and subscribe to my channel.